We'll start our service this morning with our focus song, which is the all-day song.
Our Lord, we are here to be examined by you. As Psalm 139 tells us, and we say, search us, Lord, search our hearts. Analyze us, examine us, explicate us this morning, Lord. Know all about us, we invite you. And if you find anything at all within our hearts this morning, is not pure, is not holy, we invite you, Lord, to purge it from us that we may indeed be a royal priesthood for you. We pray this in your precious name. Amen.
Be with us and walk with us and see us through the day. And we love you, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning to y'all.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I hope that you're doing well. Huh. You'll be doing better.
I think you only like working as mullies. Can you use hers?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
What about this one?
No.
Nope. We're going to share this morning. Hey, you out there in Facebook land, I hope things are going well for you. As I always like to invite, consider yourselves part of this group of people that are meeting here this morning to worship God, to praise, to uplift one another, and to know a thing or two. This first song that we're going to sing this morning has this line in it, "My hope is built." There is passive hope, like I hope the Cubs win today. And then there is active hope, which is a hope that is follow-through hope. This song invites us to follow through. Let's stand and sing.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone.
If we are going to have that active hope, if we are going to follow through, then it means that we have to walk where He leads. It therefore means if He is our Lord, we follow Him. He leads us. Let's sing.
My head.
if we are going to have that active hope, if we are going to follow through on it, if we are going to follow Him, it takes a pure and it takes a holy heart and spirit. This morning, as we sing this song, from your heart, invite God to make our hearts pure and holy, to make our hearts the sanctuary for His holiness.
And say hello to your neighbors and neighbors of Facebook and YouTube. Hello.
Worship service choreography. Hey, Devin knows. Devin knows. So anyway, Devin, why don't you sit over that way more? We're doing a thing a little different today. Keeps us on our toes. Read that. You don't have to read it all, any of it. He says it's salsa, and he would be right. I like the hot salsa. Probably most of you like it mild or medium. I like it hot. That's not my lesson this morning. So anyway, hi, news? No, not yet? Okay. So anyway, I keep checking with Molly because just every now and then we get like a comment on Facebook and I want to respond to it. So you're going to help me out this morning. Hold this. Stand up. My grandmother taught me this a long, 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 long time ago. And maybe some of you know it as well. Maybe you know it or you don't know it. Yeah, hold it upright, okay? Let's just say that you've got a brand new jar of salsa and you're trying to twist it to get the lid off, and it won't come off. It's just on there tight, right? That's happened to you, hasn't it? No? Well, okay. It's going to happen to you, all right? And it might not be salsa. It might be jelly, or it might be who knows what. And so my grandmother taught me that whenever something like that happens, you take a spoon, a metal spoon, not a plastic one, and you kind of gently tap around the edge of that lid. Now, you don't want to tap too softly because that's not going to do anything. And you don't want to tap too hard because if you damage the lid, then it's going to be even worse. You don't want to tap too hard and miss the lid because you might break the glass. Right? Right? Okay. Okay, so we're good so far. All right, you're with me? Or are you still waking up? I'm still waking up, he says. Me too. So anyway, my message this morning is going to talk about the ancient city of Jericho in part. And because the way God told the people to march around the city 6 days and everything that he told them resembled to me the idea of just kind of giving that some vibration all the way around and hold it real tight, both hands. And then the lid will just come off. Now, Zach says it was already open. In fact, you're absolutely right. And if you pay attention to my sermon this morning, okay, God says that. So you'll have to pay attention to my sermon this morning. God already had it opened. All you had to do is follow through. Devin, the idea that I have there is this. If at school, if anywhere, you're ever talking to anybody, a friend, or about Jesus, they may look at you and say, I don't get it, or I don't believe, or I don't think so. Well, don't give up on it. You know, come back around sometime and tap just a little bit more on that edge. Talk about Jesus some more. Come back around at some point in the future. Tap around on that edge a little bit more. And by golly, I bet God's just going to open it up. Does that make sense to you? In a very committed way, he says yes. Now, would you do me another favor after we pray? After we pray, I'm going to ask you to take this back to the table back there. Any one of those tables. You got your pick. Any one of them, okay? All right, let's pray. Lord, open our hearts. Make within us a pure and holy heart, Lord. Make within us, Lord, a heart that is so overjoyed with that purity and holiness that we want other people to enjoy that same feeling. Lord, cause us to be not only a sanctuary within this sanctuary, cause us to be a sanctuary out in the school place, out on the roads, out at work, wherever there may be people that we can be your sanctuary to. Allow us to do that, we pray. Amen. There you go. Here's a spoon. Is anybody in here a Swiftie? You know what I mean when I say a Swiftie? A Taylor Swift fan. Anybody in here a Swiftie? Yes. Yeah, I like some of the stuff too. On Facebook, there were four different friends of mine that were posting pictures of themselves and their friends or family at the Taylor Swift concert. And I noticed something, and the reason I asked you this morning is because your response kind of confirms it. All of those people that responded on Facebook, they went to the Taylor Swift concert, they're all blonde. They're all blonde. Well, that's why you said you like some of her material. Anyway, I'm drifting into our celebrations time. There are a number of people that had the celebration of going to a Taylor Swift concert. What are you celebrating? Because I don't think that things that you enjoy just happen. I think God gives them to you. I think God prepares them and arranges it so that you can have that moment, that Sabbath, that you know, he wants to give you gifts. And so what gifts have you received in the past week that you would like to acknowledge God for? Vicki.
Well, I'm back in my pew, which means walking restrictions have been lifted. No more restrictions.
Vicki can kick around now. There are no walking restrictions. And so she's going to dance. She's going to kick. Don't get in her way.
Right.
What else? What else? Ruth, I knew you'd have something.
We've been praying for my son, Jesse. Right, my son, Jesse, who's been in the hospital. He was released on Saturday?
Friday.
And he came over to see us yesterday. He still looks really, really bad, really weak. Has lost about 75, 80 pounds. He's really struggling right now. So please continue to pray for him. But the blessing part of that was when he came over to see us, he was actually able to walk. He's able eat a little bit, and he brought our newest grandson Osiris over to visit Grandma and Grandpa for the first time. So
Ruth's got some real celebrations there. Son Jesse is home from the hospital, and Osiris has been met. He's been grammatized, and so that's the blessing. But also, I guess Jesse's still having some difficulty, and so we're going to continue to pray for him to heal up in whatever way is possible and desirable and such. And so I believe you had your hand up.
Yeah. It's been a long road for George and I this past couple of months, and let's say it's been a long tunnel and I didn't see the light. So last week, insurance came through. The car was totaled, we will actually get a little bit of money back for that to put on another car. And George made it through his surgery okay, Auntie did get a good report from her blood doctor. She doesn't have to go back for 6 months. So little victories. God's helping us and teaching me patience. Things will happen. Just give it to him and let him.
Diane is thankful that, or thank God is providing for them, even though they've had a number of setbacks, emotional and otherwise, over the past couple of months. And so she's praising God that God finds a way for them. Back in the 80s, I had a car, somebody hit it, and it was by value, it was totaled, okay? But the insurance agent said, I'll tell you what we do, okay? We're going to give you however much money it was for that, but we don't want the car. You just do what you're going to do with it. And so I drove it around another 10 years. What else? Donna. Yeah. Really is here. There's a blessing and a prayer. Milt is home, okay, from the hospital, but obviously we're going to pray that he continues to heal up. Aurelia, it's really good to see you this morning. You know, when I saw her, you know, I can't help this, you know, and so I saw her great-grandmother of Emerson. How are you today? So that was just cute. Good to have you back. Let us stand and let us give thanks to God for all these wonderful things He brings into our lives.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Yes, let's sit back down. God was on his throne listening to our praises and thank yous to him. As we have sat down, he is now on the ladder coming down that he may be yet closer to us, that he may hear more closely what we have to offer him for prayer requests, because I believe that that's what he's more interested in. He's interested in your heart. He's interested in what's going on in your heart, your mind, and soul. And he wants to do something about it. What do you bring to God this morning to fix? He already knows about Jesse. He knows about George. George has done well, but he still needs to heal up. I've had some teeth pulled myself. It takes a while. You know, you have to learn how to talk again when people pull your teeth out of your head. You have to learn to talk again. And I know that sounds silly, but your mouth has been accustomed to so much stuff in there that your breath is working around to get out. And when it's not there, you got to like relearn how to talk. And I haven't heard yet, but I anticipated somebody would say, "No problem for you, Mike." So, George, praying for you. Diane.
I just want to reiterate praying for caregivers and praying for Angie. At 95, she's ready. She's ready for God to take her home. And the one thing that keeps her going is to go to her granddaughter's wedding, June 3rd. And yesterday, she broke down and said, she broke down and said, "I'm just tired of hurting, honey. You know, she can't get up and go right now until we get her wound better.
Right.
She can't go to her son's houses and that. She, right. You know, I mean, thank God, Lord, that the sun shined this week and we got outside and sat outside and felt the sunshine and heard the birds and played parkour. But they get to that stage where they're done. Life has been good. She's 95 and she's ready. So I just pray that God will, if he's ready for her, it's okay for me. But that God will take her peacefully and that she can go how she wants and that's in her sleep, in a peaceful way, to go to sleep and wake up in the arms of Jesus."
We're praying for Diane's Angie Lorraine. 95
years old, and we're praying for the wound that will heal so that Lorraine can be at these events that she'd like to go to, particularly the wedding. And so we're praying. We're praying for Diane. You know, we're praying for people, as Diane says, that are caregivers, but not just caregivers, love givers, people that love people that, you know, that are in that area of life. And by area of life, I mean that area where you're looking toward death. You're looking toward not only death, but the transition moment to a happier, more lengthy time. And so we're praying for you. We're praying for George. We're praying for Jesse. What we got?
I've asked for prayers for Wayne and for Carolyn, who are both out with COVID. I asked for prayers for my PT, Abby, and her husband, P, who are still in India. They had to extend their trip twice now because his mother's rehospitalized in critical condition. So I would ask for prayers for them as well. And I just lost the other one. It went right out of my head. But God knows what it was, so we'll just leave it with
Andy and B?
Addie.
Addie and B. Friends, PT, physical therapy, friends of what's your name?
Ruth.
I knew it was one of those biblical names. I was about to call you Esther or Hadassah or something, but yes, we're praying for them. We're praying for Carolyn. We're praying for Wayne. And Carolyn and Wayne have COVID. Or at least tested positive, and they represent still so many people that are going through that. And so we're praying for all those people. And we're praying for people that have pneumonia and have to survive pneumonia, maybe when they're in their 80s or I don't know. There's just so much that our bodies deal with, and as we get older, we're not really constructed to deal with them. So anyway, we're praying for Wayne, Carolyn, we're praying for Jesse, we're praying for George, we're praying for Georgia. Georgia didn't even mention anything, but Georgia, we're just going to pray for you because there you sit, and it's good to see you this morning. Georgia and I meet up at Charlie's, the convenience store out there on whatever it is. Not that we arrange to do so, but, you know, I go there to get gas. I go in to get a soft drink. Hey, Georgia. And it's like she's always there. It's our hangout, however brief. Anyway, good morning to you. Good morning, one and all. Whether you're on Facebook or you're here, there are things in your heart, whether you mention them or not, that matter deeply to you. And I'm going to say that however deeply they matter to you, more deeply they matter to God. Oh, God did not create us in all of this for us to deal with this kind of stuff. It was supposed to be a Garden of Eden where you just wake up and you just walk around and you pick your food effortlessly and all the animals just come up to you to be petted like Orville the turkey down at Shaker Village. And all of this stuff was supposed to work. We weren't supposed to deal with all of this stuff we deal with. Of course it strikes our emotions, and of course it strikes at our essence of being. All the more it strikes at God's heart. The reason I say that is because we go to God in prayer, you can be confident that He's really actively listening to us. Yes.
Ruth, remember the other one.
Roy goes into surgery tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. So please say prayers for
Roy. Ruth, Roy. Ruth's husband, Roy.
Donna's son, Roy. Richard and Randy's brother, Roy. Huh? Chuck's brother, too. Oh. Anyway, Roy, we're praying for you. You're going in for surgery. Knock him dead. All right? Just. God understands the humor. And humor is good in everything, but also it is a moment for deep humility. And so let us reach toward that deep humility as we pray. Lord, You have heard our names. You have heard our concerns. You knew them before we spoke them. You knew them before we experienced them. And so, Lord, we come to You so very humbly this morning. So very much seeking Your mercy, so very much seeking Your healing, so very much seeking Your encouragement and uplifting love. Lord, we come to You this morning knowing that You love us more than we love ourselves. It's hard for us to get around that idea, but we believe it. You love us. And so, Lord, we cast upon You all of these concerns. Not in a passive sense that You will heal us, but in that active sense. In that active sense that You have an answer, that You have a healing, that You have a presence with us. And we invite You to make that presence unmistakable within our hearts and unmistakable within our minds and unmistakable in all of the services that are rendered to us in the hospitals or in the families that appeal to us and talk to us. Lord, for those that are 95 years old and are ready to move on, we invite You, Lord, to do so according to Your timetable. But we appeal to You, Lord, to make it happen according to the most peaceful manner that is requested. Lord, we come to You this morning for puppies, and we come to You this morning for kittens, and we come to You this morning for babies like Emerson, like Miss Eloise. We come to You this morning in the fullness of the flowering, flourishing life that you remind us of. And we ask, Lord, that you heal us physically, emotionally, spiritually. That you heal our hearts, those that go on after loved ones pass away. That you heal us in our decisions to move on to a different employment area or to stay where we're at. Lord, we appeal to you that you would heal us and be present with us in all of the decisions we have to make, with all of the awkward phone calls that we take of people that are upset about insurance or whatever. Lord, attend to your people that are in this congregation, those that are in the pews, those that are in living rooms at home. Attend to us, Lord. You have made us. You breathed life into us. You knit us together. And you knit us together to come into this life for a purpose. We invite you, Lord, to heal us so that we may complete that purpose and show your glory. In the meantime, Lord, we submit to your will. We surrender all of who we are to you. Analyze us, Lord. Explore us. Explicate us, Lord. Search our hearts. And if there is anything in our hearts that does not belong, perhaps it's worry, perhaps it's anxiety, perhaps it's hatred, perhaps it's a lack of faith. If there's anything in our heart that doesn't belong, Lord, take it away. Heal us, each and every one of us. We begin our part of this prayer. We begin our part by putting to words the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'm going to invite Jim to come over to this microphone over here and bring his reading, that he may read some scripture for us.
Today's reading comes from the book of Acts, chapter 7, verses 55 through 60. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. At this, they covered their ears, and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed at him, dragged him out of the city, and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he had said this, he fell asleep. The word of God for the peoples of God.
Today's message, again, is about that awkward aspect of Christianity, which is kind of like some suffering. And then next week and beyond, we move into the more optimistic and happy aspects of being a Christian. And so I just wanted to say that to you. Is Mike going to talk about suffering yet again? Well, today. But hang on just a minute. I have to organize myself up here. And so today's message is about trusting God to get us past seemingly insurmountable obstacles. It is about recognizing Christ in His committed followers, and it is ultimately about caring so much about our community that we seek God's mercy for our community, even at our own expense, as did Stephen. So let me start by discussing the insurmountable obstacles that seem to inhibit our personal and congregational goals. I reach back to the Battle of Jericho found in the book of Joshua. It kind of went something like this. Now the gates of Jericho were securely barred because of the Israelites. No one went out, no one came in. Then the Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men. March around the city once with all the armed men. Do this for 6 days. Have 7 priests carry trumpets of ram's horns in front of the ark. On the 7th day, march around the city 7 times with the priest blowing the trumpets. When you hear them sound a long blast on the trumpets, have the whole army give a loud shout. Then the wall of the city will collapse and the army will go up, everyone straight in." The basic thing to know about Jericho is that it was spring-fed oasis. Jericho dominated the lower Jordan plain, as it had for 6,000 years or more. A couple of weeks ago, I mentioned the sharing of food as being an act of hospitality at the time of Jesus. Well, good, clean drinking water also was very scarce. If your people or your tribe or your wannabe nation happened upon such an oasis in the middle of dust and wind, you would probably want to live there. Then you would realize that other people would want to live there, and so you would build a fortress to protect your precious commodity there. Jericho was known for really strong walls and defense measures. We live in a world where the devil has put up strong walls and measures of defense around people that just go about their lives out in the community like those folk in the movie Matrix, thinking that they're just so, you know, fine just so long as they're in comfort and convenience. Those walls seem like insurmountable obstacles to us. But I'll come back to that. For now, let's talk about military tactics. We have God telling Joshua, "See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men." God speaks in past tense as if He has already accomplished the job. "Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess." But coming back to you, Zach, when you interrupted my wonderful little children's message to say, it was already loosened up and taken off. And you're right. "See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands." The job's really already done. All we have to do is our active hope follow through. Yes, God instructs a military procedure in attacking the fort. For 6 days around the city, 6 as in the creation, you know, have priests carry trumpets in front of the Ark of the Covenant. And I can imagine the priests saying, "Wait, what? You want us to go forward first, carrying the most precious things of the Israelites?" The Ark of the Covenant had all those. Yep, in front of the holiest of the religious and community objects, the Ark of the Covenant went into battle, so to speak. Being willing to risk our most holy and precious stuff is an indication that we are trusting God. Now, the remaining instructions, while seemingly weird to us, were kind of common activities of attack upon fortresses in the day. And let me read from the website. It's a Christian website. I don't know if it's Live Science or Live Science, but, well, this isn't a Christian website, but this is a science website. In April 1831, a brigade of soldiers marched in step across England's Broughton Suspension Bridge. According to the reports of the time, the bridge broke and fell apart, throwing dozens of men into the water. After this, the British Army reportedly sent new orders. Soldiers crossing a long bridge must break stride or not march in unison to stop a situation from occurring again. Structures like bridges and buildings, although they appear to be solid and immovable, have a natural frequency of vibration within them. A force that is applied to an object at the same frequency as the object's natural frequency will amplify the vibration of the object, and the occurrence, that occurrence is called mechanical resonance. Now, all of that to say is, okay, if you've got a jar of salsa that is too tight to open it, and you take a spoon and you tap around it, you are creating some vibration, and it will loosen up. That's what all of that is saying in the mechanical resonance science. I have checked that information with other engineering and science sources, and it appears to be true. I think the folk of the day of Jericho knew about it. The marching all of that time probably contributed toward the walls falling. God planned it that way. So how does that apply to our getting to know our community, our neighbors? Well, no matter how insurmountable the obstacles in the way of reaching our community and developing relationship with them, God has already delivered them. They're just waiting for us to come get them. Our part is to be as frequent in our step with each other as we make the approach. The important thing is that we don't give up on what God has already promised. My second point today, recognizing Christ and his committed followers, relates to our reading of Acts today. These immediate circumstances of Stephen seem remarkably similar. It's similar, but sometimes I like to drift into that similar thing, you know, like dropping nuclear bombs someplace. But anyway, thank you for your smiles and your chuckles. So similar to what happened to Jesus. Jesus was taken outside the city when he was to be crucified. Stephen was dragged outside the city. Just as Jesus was lifted up on the cross to die, Stephen was stoned. Just as Jesus said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit," Stephen said, "Lord, Jesus, receive my spirit." And finally, most important, Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." Stephen said, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." That is the Christ-like grace I wanted to point out. Now, for us Bible students, I can't help but point out that the scene in Luke of the crucifixion of Jesus and this scene of the stoning of Stephen were reported by the same person to the same person. From Luke chapter 1, with this in mind, since I have myself carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I too decided to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus. And in Acts chapter 1, in my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach. So we have the same writer of Luke and Acts. The things that happened to Jesus, similar with the things that happened with Stephen. I think there's something going on there. I find it intriguing anyway. What is going on, and I'm sure that the writer wants Theophilus and us to get, is that the grace of Jesus is made manifest in the lives and actions of his followers. And for sure, I don't think that we are called to submit ourselves to being stoned to death. But the important lesson is that we too, even in the face of those that intentionally harm us, we pray for them, just as Jesus did on the cross, just as Stephen, the target of stones, prayed for those stone throwers. Being Christ-like manifestation of grace in these times takes on a more social risk rather than a life and death risk. When we are figuratively pushed out of the community or our social group, as was Jesus and Stephen, we feel insulted, defensive, retaliatory. Retaliatory. I got that one right. The Jesus model, the Stephen model, is to pray for those that are doing that, to seek their forgiveness from God while they're doing it. Growing up, I have seen more of a tendency to throw insults back at people who insult us. You know, people that tell us that we're stupid for believing in prayer, stupid for believing in hell, heaven, God. So often there is a response of figuratively circling the wagons and aiming our verbal rifles at them as if to say, well, I'll put you in your place. That's not what Jesus did, and that's not what Stephen did. They prayed for those that were insulting them. I know it's difficult, emotionally and as a matter of ego, to tolerate how people want to crucify our reputations and our social standing at school. But it seems that those are the very people that Jesus calls us to befriend, forgive, and cast grace upon. Those people. These words ought to be familiar to you from Jesus. If you love those that love you, what credit is it to you? Even sinners love those that love them. If you do good only to those that do good to you, what credit is that? Even sinners do that. The way we make disciples is by showing Christ-like grace. We need to learn to practice that grace very consistently. The community in which we live, the state, our nation, the world is worthy of salvation and transformation. And I claim that because of the cross. This last Thursday at Good Shepherd, for the National Day of Prayer, I read this from George Washington in his first inaugural address. No people can be bound to acknowledge and adore the invisible hand which conducts the affairs of men more than those of the United States. Every step by which they have advanced to the character of an independent nation seems to have been distinguished by some token of providential agency. In other words, God is with us as we make our way toward breaking down the walls between us and our community. Just as God said to Joshua, "See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands." God has already delivered the community. We need to have the faith to go forth. Be creative as to how you're going to have faith in going forward in reaching your community, your geographic community, your online community, your family community, whatever communities that you live in. Trust God that God has already delivered them to you. All you have to do is make the active hope of stretching out there and inviting them. Let's pray. But Lord, we are also bewildered because we don't know where to go. We try things. We are online. We invite people. Who do you want us to invite into our home, Lord? And Lord, we know it's not about the numbers, it's about the relationships. And so how do you want us to invite? Who do you want us to invite? To what do you want us to invite? Create in us a pure and holy heart, Lord. Recreate us. May our mind be your mind, that we may see the next step that Willow Creek is to take. In your service, we pray. Amen. More than once a month. There are sometimes we do it three times in a week, like during the Lent period up to Easter. We do this in remembrance of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who willfully, John Wesley, unwillingly went to the Aldersgate thing and got his transformation there. Jesus willfully presented himself to the cross. And so we do this in remembrance of all of that, that Jesus is and was and continues to be, not only in the whole history of whatever, but in our hearts as well. Because at some point in the past, either you were baptized or you're going to be baptized, every knee, every tongue. At some time in the past, you were baptized. And you were baptized not only into the eternity of Jesus, but into all of His love and all of His grace and all of what we are called to do to follow through. That's what we remember. We remember the sacrifice. We remember the resurrection. But we remember everything that Jesus taught and how we are to act. That's what we do in remembrance of Christ. And we don't do it of our own human spirit. We do that of the Holy Spirit. We call upon the Holy Spirit this morning, that the Holy Spirit will make us a holy priesthood, looking at each other and being so totally reconciled with each other, and so totally reconciled with whoever may be home and whoever may be out there in Facebook land, whoever may have hurled insults at us, whoever we may have hurled insults to, the Holy Spirit to reconcile us all for this moment in which we remember the cross and we remember the hope and we remember all that Jesus taught us when we were baptized or when we will be. It is indeed the Holy Spirit that works within us, works within this sanctuary, and works to take these elements of simple bread, broken for us, made for us lovingly at the hands of Vicky, but by the power of the Holy Spirit made for us to be the body of Christ. And it is by the power of the Holy Spirit that this Welch's grape juice, again lovingly brought by Vicky, by the power of the Holy Spirit, is made for us to be the blood of Jesus. Praise God. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, by the mission and the reconciliation of Jesus, we do this in remembrance. It is not a remembrance like, oh yeah, I remember the Cubs won back in 2016. No. It is a remembrance that reaches into our souls at the time that we were baptized or will be baptized. And we remember the essence of what it is to be with Jesus. Let us pray at this moment. Our Lord, in fact, we pray that you do bless these elements, that you do transform them before us, that they become your body, your blood, and that we share these elements. We share you. We share you, Lord, with each other. The most precious, the most scarce of human nutrients here, we share with each other as you model for us to do. We pray your blessing. Amen. I invite our communion stewards to come forward. Extraordinary love of Jesus for you, his body broken for you. The mysterious love of Jesus, the blood of Jesus poured for you. It is our precious Lord and Savior that invites you to come forward. That is the finest interpretation of that hymn ever I have heard anywhere. If you're not blessed by that, you've been blessed by something else today. The Lord wants to make you fruitful in all of your relationships and in all of your ministries. I leave you in peace.
Please stand as we sing our benediction.
Take care.